ألف لام ميم. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم، نزل عليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه وأنزل التوراة والإنجيل من قبل، هدى للناس وأنزل الفرقان. إن الذين كفروا بآيات الله لهم عذاب شديد، والله عزيز ذو انتقام. إن الله لا يخفى عليه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلقه أجمعين وبعد. We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon the masterpiece Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless his entire household and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all the messengers that he has sent from the beginning of time right to the end where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and make us from amongst those who can learn, put into practice and convey this deen in a way that it can get to our children and offspring up to the day of Qiyamah. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we were looking at the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We had got to a point where he had taken part in what was known as Hilful Fudul, or the pledge where they had to, or they pledged to assist those who were oppressed against the oppressor. And we also got to the point where he had traveled to Ash-Sham once again, to the Syrian region as we call it today. And as I explained, it includes not only the country of Syria, but that entire region where Lebanon, Palestine and parts of Northern Arabia are included. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was noticed by Maysara, who was the slave of Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, that the cloud was covering him, was shading him throughout the journey. This was something amazing. Not only was the tree, or had the tree turned when earlier in his life, but the later journey to that region, there was always a cloud that covered him and no one besides him. Subhanallah. So when Maysara had come back to Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, and she was told about what had happened, she knew within herself that this man, something great, something very big about him, he is about to be a leader, or there is something grand about him. And this was also one of the reasons, over and above the character and conduct and honesty and so on that we had heard about yesterday, that made her propose for the marriage to him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us spouses who will be the coolness of our eyes. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all those who are not married to be married to those who will be the coolness of their eyes. Remember, marriage is a very big sacrifice. People don't realize and understand. Some people think it's a perpetual honeymoon. We have a problem with today's generations where the young girls are looking for men who are already wealthy, who have everything in life, and all they need to do is now fit on the man's arm and walk to the mall. That's what some people think. But they don't realize those who have had humble beginnings, where they have struggled for several years, sometimes decades, and then come up on their two feet, sometimes those marriages are much more blessed than hunting for the wealthiest of all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. The reason I make mention of this, look at the choice of Khadija radiallahu anha. She chose a man orphaned. She chose a man who basically had nothing besides honesty, dignity, and that high, lofty level of character and conduct, subhanallah. And yet he had never taken part in anything that would have put a mark on his reputation, or put a negative mark on his reputation. We have another very, very important incident that occurred when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was 35 years old, 10 years into his marriage. We had made mention yesterday of his children and how he lost his sons, and that his daughters had actually lived and they had seen the day when he was granted prophethood and so on. But an incident where Quraysh found that the Kaaba, which is the center of the earth according to us, the Kaaba in Makkatul Mukarramah, Quraysh had found that this house was being destroyed, or it was run down because of two reasons. One is there had been some fires that had taken place in the past, and they weakened some of the building. And thereafter, there was some floods. There were floods that had destroyed some of the walls or part of the walls of the Kaaba. So Quraysh decided, we need to rebuild this house. Now remember, the house was built by Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. There is a narration which states that it was built first by Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, but that narration is not authentic. The most authentic narrations point towards the building of the Kaaba by Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And after that, it had never been touched. For your information, how it was built at the first time, no cement, nothing to hold the bricks together. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam by going down and picking bricks, picking little rocks, and each rock like jigsaw puzzles fitted onto the other. So the big rocks were actually one above the other with nothing to hold them together, and yet they lasted generations. So at this point, Quraysh decided, let's bring it down. But they were frightened, they were scared. Why? The house of Allah. How can we bring it down? This is the house, this is the bait, this is the first house, all the people come to it, all our idols are there, everything is there. How can we destroy this house? So Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, who was one of the men of Quraysh, he built the courage, plucked it up, and he said, you know what? What's our intention? Our intention is to rebuild it correctly, properly. So why should we fear? The intention is not to destroy, it's actually to bring down in order to build. So he said, I will start. What's wrong? And he started, and he started destroying a little bit. And thereafter, that evening, they all slept and they waited for punishment. They were wondering what's going to happen. When nothing came, the next day he continued and everybody joined in, and the different clans were given different parts of the Kaaba to bring down and to rebuild. And amazingly, what had happened is they brought it down and they started building it. The question arises, how far down did they bring it? When they hit a certain point where they saw some green foundation, green rock foundation, they stopped there. Amazing. So the foundation we have today, the foundation of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And how was it built? It was actually built where it had two corners, and as for the other side, it was rounded. You see what we know as the Hatim today, the Hijr Ismail as they call it, it was part of the Kaaba. So the two corners, one where the Hajar Aswad is and the other one where what we know as Rukun Yamani is, and on the other side it was more like a dome, more like a mihrab. And what had happened, they brought it down and they decided that we are going to build this properly. And in order to build it, we are not going to accept wealth that is haram. So anyone who's got interest money, we're not accepting it. Imagine, the people of Quraysh knew, the pagan Arabs knew that interest is oppression. They knew it. Why? Because you're milking it out of a poor man. You're milking it out of him, and he's actually paying for nothing, for time in fact. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So they knew that that was wrong. They said, we are not going to accept that type of money here. No interest. And this is made mention of in all the books of Seerah. The second point, they said, no wealth of immorality. Anyone who has earned immoral wealth, the women who wanted to give money or the men, if it was immoral, we're not accepting it. And the third type of money they did not accept, or wealth, was anyone who deceived or conned or cheated anyone out of any money, please keep it away, we don't want it. Believe it or not, they did not come up with so much wealth. Allahu Akbar. They came up with just a little bit, and they started rebuilding the Kaaba. When they started rebuilding the Kaaba, two things happened. One is, they ran out of wealth. What type of wealth? They couldn't build it exactly as it was again. So they decided, what we'll do, we'll close it as the square or the cube, and when we get wealth, we'll actually complete it at some time. But there was another problem. There was the honor of the Hajar Aswad, this black stone that we know. The honor of placing it where it is supposed to be. And all these tribes are arguing who should have the honor. Remember, the argument about Zamzam was solved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This time, Abdul Muttalib was gone. Abu Talib was there. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his uncle Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the two of them took part in putting the bricks of the Kaaba from their clan. And as this happened and the debate pursued, the building stopped. In some narrations, some books of Seerah say for 3 nights. There was a debate, argument. They almost went to war as to who must put it. So that one evening they sat and they said, okay, whoever is going to enter the masjid first, whoever is going to enter the masjid first, we will make that person The one who's going to judge between us as to who is going to place this particular stone in its place. And who came up with this idea? Abu Umayyah ibn al-Mughira. He was one of the pagans, one of the leaders of Quraysh, and he came up with this idea and everybody agreed. So they didn't tell anyone, but they waited. Lo and behold, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the first one to walk in. He hadn't known. When he came in, they told him that, look, we are so happy that you walked in. Al-Amin, you are the most trustworthy. You are the one, subhanallah, who has no negative scratch on his slate, subhanallah. And you are the one we look up to. At this stage, remember, as we said, he was quite old, 35 years old. He had a lot of respect. And he was not just a pauper from anywhere. Now he had wealth. Remember, he did business. And he went up to Syria, Sham, the region of Sham, and he came back with the caravans, and he was an honest, upright person, lots of barakah in his wealth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him in every single way. So here, they told him, we need you to resolve the matter. You tell us who should lay the stone. So he said, okay, give me a piece of cloth. This had solved the problem, subhanallah. They were wondering, what is he asking for a piece of cloth for? They gave him a huge piece of cloth. And he said, every clan, one representative must catch one part of the cloth. That corner, this corner, the other one. And then he placed the stone in the middle. And they, when it was placed in the middle, they carried it right to its place. And when it got to its place, he lifted it with his hands and he put it in place. Problem solved. Subhanallah. Big problem solved. So the honor of placing the stone was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's. Look at Allah's plan. And yet all the clans were happy because none of them could say, we did and we did not. They all took part in it and each one of them carried it, they lifted it, they brought it, and all he did was put it in its place. So this was also an amazing rank that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now if you take a look at the Kaaba, it's important for us to make mention of the building of the Kaaba. We said the first time it was ever built was at the time of Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, and it had a semicircular on one side. The second time was this Quraysh, time of Quraysh, where they did not have enough wealth to complete it, so they had it like a cube, and they lifted it much higher than it was at the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. They lifted it to 18 feet high, and they had six wooden pillars inside which were holding the roof. So they actually put a roof on it now. And thereafter it stayed like that until the time of Yazid ibn Muawiyah, when Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu built the Kaaba again. And it had been damaged. And thereafter, when he built it again, what did he do? He built it according to the original building, where he added the semicircular once again, what Quraysh had wanted to do. And this, he did it because at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha says that he said to her that if these people were not freshly ignorant, they are just coming out from the ignorance and they might get excited if we bring the Kaaba down or we tamper with it, I would have built it according to its original building that was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam, and I would have put another door on the other side so people could get in and out and so on. So he didn't do it in his lifetime sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he said, well, if I were able to do this and if the people were not fresh from ignorance, remember it was only after the victory of Makkah that he would have been able to actually achieve that. And he said, no, these people might look at it from a different angle and therefore we leave it as it is. So Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu, he had the opportunity later on at the time of Yazid ibn Muawiyah, when Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu was basically the head of Makkah, the ruler of Makkah. Some considered him as the Amir. And subhanallah, he built this in its original form once again. And thereafter, it was rebuilt once again at the time of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, when again it had been damaged. And you see what was happening is the floods came in and so on. What Quraysh did is they lifted the door higher than what it was so that water doesn't get in. So if you see today the Kaaba, the door is very high. You can only get up with steps, because what was happening initially was it was flat. The door was on the ground level and water would get in and be inside. So now that they lifted it up, the water would not get in. And up to today, there are floods that happen in Makkah in the Mataf, but the water does not get into the Kaaba, subhanallah. Up to today, I have seen a time when the water in the mataf was up to my knees. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Not many years ago. And subhanallah, you find the Kaaba was protected. In fact, now there is something known as a mizab, which they placed right on the roof. And it is a little gutter from which the water actually comes off the roof, so it doesn't stay there. So Abdul Malik ibn Marwan was the last who rebuilt the Kaaba. And how did he rebuild it? He rebuilt it exactly how Quraysh had rebuilt it. And this is how it is today, according to the building of Quraysh. And for your information, what happened lately, the Saudi Arabian government, they did not rebuild the Kaaba, but all they did is they strengthened it. So they put a little marble coating outside and inside, and they strengthened the pillars because these wooden pillars were being eaten by ants. And they strengthened and reinforced the roof or the ceiling, whatever we'd like to call it. And all they did was they reinforced. So they did not destroy it and rebuild it, but they reinforced it. So this is the history of the Kaaba. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take us there again and again. Remember, there is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He says, وَجَعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِّنَ النَّاسِ تَهُوِي إِلَيْهِمْ O Allah, let the hearts of the people incline towards them, which is Mecca and the people of it. So aren't our hearts inclined to Mecca and Medina? Dua of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Today, who would say no, mashallah? Those who have already been for Hajj, applying once again for Hajj. And you know what's the irony? They ask you a question, have you been before? You say, no, we haven't. Allahu Akbar. We want to go again, isn't it? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our shortcomings. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive, really, forgive us. Sometimes we become, you know, so engrossed in wanting something that we forget that in the process we're doing something wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. This is the history of the Kaaba, the honor given to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we have the rank of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being known by the people from the very beginning, from before this pagan time. Allah had already prepared humanity for the advent or the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take a look at the prophets of before. They had made mention of the fact that there is a prophet to come. Every time a Nabi came, it was his duty to inform his people that another Nabi after me is going to come. So much so that some of them had made mention of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come. Look at the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam in Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ibrahim alayhi salam made a dua. What was this dua? رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ This was in Mecca. The children of Ismail, Ibrahim alayhi salam, is saying, O Allah, send from amongst them a messenger for them. Who will recite the verses? Who will come to them with guidance, with wisdom? And who will cleanse them in the sense that they will be able to be cleansed if they follow that message? And O Allah, you are the most powerful, most wise. This was the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam to grant the children of Ismail a Nabi from amongst them. Who was that Nabi? It was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He came from the children of Ismail. The other Anbiya were from the children of Ishaq, Isaac. May peace be upon him and may peace be upon them all. So this was the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Let me make mention of something else in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Torah and the Injil. The Torah revealed to Musa alayhi salam. The Injil or the Bible revealed to Isa, Jesus, may peace be upon him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran,
الذين يتبعون الرسول النبي الأمي الذي يجدونه مكتوبا عندهم في التوراة والإنجيل
Allah is praising those who follow the prophet who is unlettered, whom they find his name mentioned in the Torah and the Injil. So Allah says thereafter, whoever follows him and assists him, they will indeed be from amongst the successful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success. We always hear that success lies in following what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has brought. Firstly, he brought the Quran. And then he brought his sunnah, his entire sunnah and the teachings of the entire sharia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. We have such a great gift. Even if we look at the Quran, Isa, Jesus, may peace be upon him, clearly makes mention. And this is made mention of not only in the Quran, but even in the testaments. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept it such that up to today, we can read the King James version of the Bible and we will find mention of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The difficulty is, normally people don't translate a name. If I say, Robert came to me. Now whatever the meaning of Robert is, say for example, it is a person who is high in rank. So if I say a high ranking person came to me, I've changed the meaning. I was supposed to say the proper noun, the name. If I say high ranking, it could be anyone. But the minute I say Robert, we know who we are talking about. Just because I'm Zimbabwean doesn't mean I chose that name because it's our president. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all, grant us peace and stability and calmness throughout the globe, not only in our countries, but alhamdulillah, since we're making mention of it, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the goodness He has bestowed upon us in this part of the world, and we ask Him not to take it away from us because of our sins, for indeed we are blessed in ways that sometimes we will never know until it goes away. Then we might realize, you know, a long time ago we were actually blessed in this way and that way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So, the term Muhammad was translated as the Comforter, the Praised One, the Comforter, and so on. These words are mentioned, and they are mentioned where? In the Bible, in the King James version of the Bible, and even the other versions of the Bible. But you will see, they have been translated that, oh, that's the Holy Ghost. Oh, that's John the Baptist. Oh, that's someone else. No, this is a messenger. It's quite clear. In fact, if you look at the Hebrew script in the Torah, mention is made of something very similar to the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammadim. And normally the term IM is added for respect. And then they translated it. When they translated it, the name was lost. Allahu Akbar. And the Gospel of Barnabas, where there was clear cut mention of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, conveniently was removed completely from the Bible, taken out. So you won't even find it in most of the 36 or 42 different versions of the Bible that are floating on the globe today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand. We are fortunate we have one authentic book, no matter where you go, it is the same, it is recited. This evening, mashallah, we recited verses, the whole masjid has the right to scream out what is right. When the imam is wrong, it's a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to test the rest. Who is going to correct this? Because it's an amana. And the imam can never be upset when he is corrected, never ever. If an imam gets angry that he is corrected, he has not understood the amana that is on his shoulders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. May He grant us humility and may He make us from those who realize the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. Really, if you were to go to China and read the Quran, believe me, those Chinese, they probably don't know how to ask you what your name is and how old you are and where you come from, but they can correct you when you recite the Quran, subhanallah, because they know it. So, mention was made even by Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. وَإِذْ قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ مصدقا لما بين يدي من التوراة ومبشرا برسول يأتي من بعد اسمه أحمد. And remember when Jesus, the son of Mary, may peace be upon him, told his people, O children of Israel, I am a messenger of Allah to you, confirming the Torah that has already been revealed and informing you of a messenger who will come after you by the name of Ahmad. And then Allah says, فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ قَالُوا هَذَا سِحْرٌ مُّبِينٌ. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with clear cut signs, they said, this is magic, clear magic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and safeguard us. So where is the messenger who was supposed to come after Jesus? Where is he? They have not said there is anyone after him. Nowadays, if you look at the Christians and ask them, so where is the messenger? What answer do they have? If you look at the Jews who follow Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, ask them, where is the next messenger? They will be silent. So where is he? Well, there is no other option but for it to be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And do you know what? Something beautiful we have to make mention of. The message is the same. Exactly the message that the Christians have and the Jews have, the Muslims have. So, if we look at the Sharia that was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would find the division into two different categories. One is belief and one is day-to-day rules and regulations. As for belief, From the time of Adam, coming to Noah, coming to Jacob, coming to all the children, coming to Moses, coming to Aaron, coming to all those, may peace be upon them all. Coming to Jesus, may peace be upon him. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Belief was always the same. They all taught in the life after death. They all taught to worship one God alone. Worship your maker and nobody else. There is no one worthy of worship besides the one who made you, the one whom you are going to return to. That was the message, lil awwalina wal akhirin, from the beginning right to the end, always. And for the beginning and for the end. And there will be a life after death, and you will be answerable, and you will be resurrected, and there is heaven, and there is hell. In terms of belief, the message is ditto, exactly the same. From the beginning, every messenger came with the same message in terms of belief. But the day-to-day rules and regulations, what is permissible, what is prohibited, it changed with the changing of time. And each Nabi came with a different Sharia. And what happened is the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the final Sharia, and that is going to last up to the end of time. Let me inform you, no prophet has ever said, I am the last one, besides Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. None of them. The Christians do not believe that Jesus, peace be upon him, said that I am the last one. They don't believe that. And the Jews do not believe that Moses, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, said that I am the last one. No, they don't believe that. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam was the only one who said he is the last one. We believe he was the last one. For your information, several years ago when I was researching this topic, I found something very interesting where some of the Orthodox Christians believe, and this was a belief not from us, but from them, that the Almighty will never leave mankind for more than 2,000 years without sending a messenger. So what happened? If you look at the gaps between the messengers, according to them, never more than 2,000. Thereafter, you know, we had the Y2K issue when people said the world is coming to an end in 1999. Why? Because now there either needs to be a messenger or there needs to be doom. So because there's no messenger, there's going to be doom. And guess what? We saw the 1st of January 2000, mashallah. So somewhere down the line they went wrong. There was a messenger who came a long, long time ago. We don't believe that as Muslimin. But it's interesting to see how now suddenly they're very quiet about it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. It's like some people from amongst us, they say the Mahdi was born 40 years ago, and the Mahdi was born so many years ago. He's going to come out in 1993. People look for him, he didn't come. Coming out in 1999, they look for him, he didn't come. 20,000, meaning 2,000, no, he didn't come. And then 2005, he didn't come. Now they're saying 2012, Allahu A'lam, Allah knows best. But all this is just something which people are guessing and trying. If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could not pinpoint when the Mahdi is coming, who are we to be able to suddenly pinpoint when he is going to come? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us prepare, rather than just blow our trumpet about things that are perhaps, you know, coming, but to try and pinpoint when exactly they're happening, we will probably lose focus as to what we are supposed to be doing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So Isa alayhi salam makes mention of it, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam makes mention of it, and we made mention of how it is also in the Bible and the Torah. And if you look at the people at the time, what had happened, very interesting. The Jews had already been told there is a man who's going to be sent in Arabia between two deserts where there are date palms. Between two deserts where there are date palms, that is where he will finally end up. He's going to migrate to that area. Now, if you were told someone is coming in Arabia, well, Arabia extends from far east to west to north to south, large land. Where are you going to go? You won't know. But if someone told you, ultimately he's going to migrate to a place which has date palms between two deserts, you can go to one of two areas, either to Tabuk, or either you can go to Medina Munawwara. Because Medina Munawwara, subhanallah, there are date palms between the deserts. And if you take a look at Tabuk and that area, Allah, in fact Khaybar, not Tabuk, the area near Khaybar, you will find something quite similar as well. Not very far off from Medina Munawwara. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. So what they did, they started descending south from where they were in the north in Sham. And they began to come to do what? To prepare to meet this messenger according to their books. This is why the Jewish clans settled around Medina Munawwara. For your information, where did they come from? They came from further up north. Why did they come? They came to welcome this messenger. But they did not expect him not to be from amongst them, because they were used to all the messengers being from the children of Ishaq. This is what it was. Allahu Akbar. So you look at Banu Nadir, Banu Qaynuqa. They had from amongst them the leaders, those who were very pious, those who knew the Torah inside out, those who told their people, people are coming here. In fact, the Ansar, do you know what they say? They say that these Jewish people in Medina Munawwara, they used to tell us the messenger is coming anytime now. When he comes, we are going to be fighting you in the same way that Ad and Thamud were fought before, and we will destroy you to bits and pieces with that messenger. When he came, they rejected him because he was from the cousin side. Look at the racism, look at the tribalism, look at the all this type of nepotism that took place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Allahu Akbar. Remember, virtue is virtue. If a man comes from far off, different race, different size, totally unacceptable in terms of financial level, no problem. For as long as his message is solid, you take it. Maybe Allah gave him something that he has not given in your children or around you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never make us from those who lose opportunities when we have them. You never know who is going to have a message that will turn your whole life and that will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't take things lightly. Listen, and this is why we need to attend the talks. When people have talks in the masajid, in our community we have ulama who tirelessly work. They have their lessons, they have their ahadith, they have their daily readings and so on. Try to attend. Try to make it a point. You never know which 5 minutes of your time could actually result in the changing of your whole life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change our lives towards positive. So here, the people had come to this area. I want to make mention of a few incidents because it's very important for us to know what had happened. If you take a look at the people of the book, they knew him. Some of them accepted him when he came in as a Nabi. Some of them rejected him. All those who rejected him only did it because he was not from amongst them. Nothing else. It's not my son, so I'm not reading behind that one, making noise. But when your son reads, then everybody's going to be there. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. We don't want that ignorance in us. We don't want the ignorance whereby we get jealous because the deen is with someone else. And the spreading of it is with someone else. Make dua for them, learn from them, benefit from them, and make dua that Allah grant it to us and our offspring as well. Let me give you the one story of a Sahabi known as Salama ibn Salama radiallahu anhu. He says, we had a neighbor who was a Jewish man. And one day he came out to us when we were sitting and he started telling us something. What was he saying? Now remember, these people were, they used to worship idols, subhanallah, idol worshippers. And this Jewish man was not an idol worshipper. He used to worship Allah alone. And he came out and what did he say? He said, do you know there is life after death? Oh, the kuffar did not used to believe that. Do you know there is heaven, there is hell? Look at the Jewish beliefs, just like ours. Do you know there is heaven, there is hell? You are going to be resurrected. You are going to be accountable for all your deeds and you will either go to heaven and hell. They said, hey, relax. What are you talking about here? Can there be heaven? After we die, there's going to be something. You mean we're going to come back to life? He said, yes. What's the sign of it? They asked him. So he says, the sign of it is, you know what? We're about to witness the coming of a messenger in this area anytime now. So they said, when will that be? So he looked at Salama ibn Salama radiallahu anhu. He was the youngest from amongst them, young boy. He looked at him and he says, if this boy is given life, he will definitely see him because we are already there. The time has come. It's reported that some days later, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. Subhanallah. Some days later, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. And you know what? This same man did not accept. So they all told him, but weren't you the one telling us that someone will come? He brought exactly the message you are saying now. He's meaning you just said he brought exactly that message. Why don't you accept? He says, no, we're not going to accept him because we didn't expect him to be from amongst you guys. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this. Then we have another lesson. Ka'b al-Ahbar. He was a man who did not accept Islam at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is reported that at the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he accepted Islam. So he is one of those who saw the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he's not a sahabi because he wasn't a mu'min at that time. He only accepted Islam after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Amazing. So this Ka'b al-Ahbar, do you know what he says? A Jewish man, he says, the qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam are mentioned in the Torah. exactly how they are made mention of in the Quran. And he says he is a messenger who speaks well. He doesn't lie. He comes with goodness. He doesn't eat any charities, but he might eat from a gift. And he is a person who is very eloquent, very calm, very clean. He doesn't swear. He doesn't cheat in business. And he teaches goodness. He only teaches that which is good and so on. And you know what? When the teachings came, he delayed in accepting the message. Just Allah had blessed him that he had had life long enough to accept Islam. But he was not written from amongst the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, as I explained a few moments ago, because he accepted Islam only at the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. Then there is another incident that is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, who says, when he was asked, he says, Wallahi, the qualities of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have been mentioned in the Torah just like they are mentioned in the Quran. And he read the verse,
Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira. وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا.
O messenger, we have sent you as a witness, as a bearer of good news, and as a warner at the same time, and a caller who calls towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his permission, and so on. The verse, subhanallah. So these qualities are mentioned in the Torah, and this is made mention of in Sahih al-Bukhari. And what happened? It is also made mention that the messenger will come. Which messenger? The one who will open the eyes that have been blind. The one who will open the ears that would have been deaf. The one whom Allah will open through the hearts that were blocked. So it's Allah who does that, but through the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amazing. Now what does this mean? People have eyes, we see, but sometimes we don't take notice. We don't benefit from what we see. We see lesson after lesson, nothing helped. So Allah opens your eyes, so now it will help you that you've seen something. Sometimes we hear a message, powerful, we know this is the truth, but it doesn't strike us because we haven't heard it with the correct ears. And suddenly, one day, something happens and it strikes. So who opened your ears? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same applies to our hearts. Sometimes our hearts are so hardened, we keep on sinning and we keep on transgressing, thinking Allah Ghafoorur Rahim, Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. Nothing changes us until one day Allah wants to open the heart. So something happens and the heart opens and suddenly we are softened by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though that particular item might have been a point of negativity in our lives. So this is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take a look at Salman al-Farisi. Who was he? Radiallahu anhu. He was Persian. He was from a noble family. They used to worship the fire. He refused. He went away to some monks. And the story is nice and long. But let me make mention of the main aspect of it. It is reported that he was told by one of the monks that he was with in Ammuriyah, is the name of a place. And he was told by this religious man that, you know what? I am now close to my death. And I'd like to tell you that a man is going to come who's going to preach the religion of Ibrahim. What was that? Monotheism. Worship one Allah. One. Worship your maker alone. That's the beauty of Islam. What makes us Muslim? We only surrender to the one who made us. We never worship a person or a stick or a stone or a grave or a tree. No. The beauty of Islam lies in one thing, and that is we worship our maker alone, the one who made us, the one whom we are going to return to. That's it. So there's no risk involved as Muslims. When we put our heads on the ground, what do we say? O you who made us, you are the greatest. O worshipped one, you are the greatest. Is there anything wrong with that statement? When we say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, we are actually saying, glory be to the maker. Rabbun is the one who made us. And the one who is in absolute control of every aspect of our existence, you are indeed the highest. What's wrong with that statement? How can people say, we worship idols, we worship people, we worship Muhammad, we worship this, we worship a black box in Makkah? A'udhu billah. Nay, that is wrong. We don't. We actually worship our maker alone. So this was what Salman al-Farisi was told. This is what intrigued them from the very beginning to this day. Islam being very, very fast in spreading on the globe. What is it that is driving the people to Islam? It is the concept of Godhood. The fact that you have a direct link with your maker and you only worship your maker and none other than him. Neither a messenger, nor an angel, nor a stick, nor a stone, nor an idol, nor wealth, nor anything besides your maker. لا La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Salman al-Farisi, when he was told that, he was also told that this man will not accept sadaqah for himself. Sadaqah meaning charities. He will take a gift, but not a charity. And he will have a mark on his back, which will be the size of a pea. That will be known as the seal of prophethood. And he is a person who will have good character. He will call towards goodness, and he will call towards fulfilling the rights of others and so on. So Salman al-Farisi says, you know what? I was actually told by this particular monk that, you know, he will be between two deserts where there are date palms. So he went to Medina Munawwara. Long story, in the process he was enslaved. And when he was brought to Medina Munawwara, he was so happy because he landed up exactly where he wanted. And at the time of Hijrah, when he saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard the message, correct message. He was happy. Then he said, let me check. So he gave him something and said, this is a charity. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not take from it. He gave it away. And then he came the next day or some time later and he gave a gift. And he says, this is not a charity, it's just a gift. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam partook from it. Subhanallah. Then he had an opportunity to see the seal of prophethood. And then his heart just softened up and he bore witness, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The same applies to another, Abdullah ibn Salam. And his name, according to some of the narrations, was Al-Husayn at one stage, just prior to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam giving him the name Abdullah. He was a Jewish rabbi. He was from Banu Qaynuqa. Banu Qaynuqa was one of the tribes that had come to settle just around Medina Munawwara, one of the areas there. And what happened is when he came, he used to teach his people, and he was one of the highest of the lot. And he was the leader of the Jews there, the leaders of Banu Qaynuqa. And when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he looked, he says, as we mentioned day one, we said when he saw the face of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, this is not the face of a liar. I can see that this man is truthful. It's not the face of a liar, subhanallah. So he heard the message. It was a message full of peace. One narration says some of the first words that were mentioned were, أيها الناس أفشوا السلام وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا الأرحام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخلوا جنة ربكم بسلام. This is according to one of the narrations that he heard the words, first words, O people, spread peace, spread salam, and feed the people, and maintain your family relations, and fulfill prayer at night when everyone is asleep, and you will be able to enter paradise with ease. Allahu Akbar. And he says, when I heard that, I knew that this man is actually truthful. And he says he tiptoed from the back to look and to see what was happening. He came forth and he declared his shahada. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him at that time that, listen, they explained to him who he was. He says, okay, why don't you bring your people, Banu Qaynuqa? And why don't you explain to them, I'm the leader, I've accepted the message, it's a correct message. And you people, come on. So he said, my people, I know them better. They will never accept. What's the reason? Because you're not from their clan. You're not from them. You're actually from the children of Ismail, not from the children of Ishaq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, why don't you just wait behind this wall? There was a wall. And he called Banu Qaynuqa, some of the leaders. And he says, who is this man in your midst? They said, oh, he is a leader, a son of a leader. Honorable, a son of an honorable, truthful, son of the truthful, one of our wise men, the leader from amongst us. That's who he is. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them, what if I tell you he accepted me as the messenger? They said, that is impossible. He can never ever do that. Not you, no ways. It can't happen. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him from behind and says, come, come forth. So when he came forth, he says, Ya Rasulullah, inni ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka abduhu wa rasuluhu. You know what they said? Immediately they said, oh, he's a cheat and his father was a cheat. He's the lowest from amongst us and so was his father. And he is a traitor and so was his father. And he has deceived us and so did his dad. And they went away. Allahu Akbar. Look at this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make our hearts hard. The lesson we learn from that. Allah shows us signs in our lives to leave sin, to turn to Him, to read salah, to fight laziness when it comes to obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to please shaitan, to try our best to turn in tawbah. But sometimes we don't turn, we continue in our sin. And if you really study the sin, wallahi, it's worth nothing. It's worth nothing at all. What did we achieve by it? There is much more sweetness in the obedience of Allah than there is in engaging in any sin ever. Believe me. The sins, all they can be is for a moment or two, a little bit of pleasure. After that, there is regret on top of it, shame on top of it. Perhaps even a person may be belittled in front of society and community, and they may not know where to hide their face only because they displeased Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that cannot happen when we obey the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are some of the statements that were coming from the people. In fact, there is a man known as Abu Tayhan. And he too, he makes mention, he came from Ash-Sham, the region in the north. And he came down to this area in Arabia, Medina Munawwara. He lived with Banu Qurayza. And what happened? On his deathbed, he tells Banu Qurayza, "Do you know why I left the land which is so rich and so full of food and drink, and I came to the land that is full of hunger," meaning Hijaz, "and I have come to this land where there is nothing?" They said, "Well, you know better." He says, "Because there is a messenger who is going to come in this land according to the Bible and the Torah. And according to the books, this is the land he's going to come in. So I am here waiting for him." Sadly, what happened? He passed away. He passed away before the sending of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam as a messenger. Then another piece of evidence to prove that the world was waiting for this man. Heraclius. What happened when Quraysh had sent their team to him? He asked them the question, "This man who's claiming to be a messenger, who is he, what is he," and so on, so many questions. And Abu Sufyan was responding. And Abu Sufyan gave one response after another. The point being raised is, at the end, Heraclius says, "Yes, we have been waiting for this man, but I did not expect him to come from amongst you." Same thing. Look at how this thing comes from person to person, where because it's not from us, now we don't want it. It's someone else. This person is a different tribe, a different clan. They come from a different area, different continent, different color. So we don't want to accept. That is ignorance. That will keep people away from what is right. Remember that. It did the same at that time, and it repeats itself even now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So this was something very, very important. Another man who also spoke very highly, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not intend for him to accept Islam. His name was Umayyah ibn Abi Salt. He was a poet. He was a top brain, very intelligent. He did not worship the idols. And he did not drink. He prohibited it. And he used to worship according to the worship of Ibrahim alayhi salam, one God alone. And he had read. He was one of the literate from amongst Quraysh. Literate, he could read. Thaqif. He came from Ta'if, in fact. He was a Thaqafi. And what happened is, his poetry was taken by the Arabs at large, one of the most eloquent people. So much so, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to enjoy later on, after Nubuwa, listening to the poetry of Umayyah ibn Abi Salt. And one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard 100 couplets, and he says, "In kada la yuslim." This man was about to be a Muslim. So what stopped him? Well, he read the books and he knew there is a messenger coming from this area. He was excited. He was hoping it would be him because he was very pious. So when the messenger came, he rejected. Why? He was jealous. Look at what jealousy does. And he died on that condition. Imagine. And yet he was a person who all he had to do was now believe in Muhammadur Rasulullah, because he had the La ilaha illallah in him already. But he missed the other half. So what happened to him? He died as a disbeliever. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. This is what jealousy does. When we become jealous that the deen has come one side and not here, then we can lose from it. So let's not let that overtake us ever. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors and grant us goodness. Yesterday I made mention of a very interesting point, one of the signs of Nubuwa. Now we are moving closer to the time when the angel came in. We would find Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "When I was in Makkah al-Mukarrama, I know a stone that used to make salam to me." Imagine. And you know what he says? He says it later on in this hadith, is reported by Jabir ibn Samurah in Sahih Muslim. He says, "I know the stone up to now. I know which stone it is." Subhanallah. Amazing. And some other narrations say not only that stone, but several other stones. Now someone might think, how can a stone make salam to the messenger? Well, look at Musa alayhi salam. Didn't he have a stick that actually ate up all the other serpents of those magicians? What about Sulaiman alayhi salam? Couldn't he speak to the wind and the other creatures? So this was a messenger, the highest of all messengers. Nothing strange about a rock making salam to him. These creatures knew who he was. Subhanallah, they knew exactly who he was. Look at the cloud refusing to let the sun harm, yet he wasn't even a Nabi at the time. Subhanallah. And this is authentic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May he grant us goodness. Sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. This is Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what had happened is, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent letters at one stage later on to all the leaders around. I'm sure we know that. Well, how did they treat the letters? How they treated the letters already proves that they knew there is a messenger coming. Because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was no force to be reckoned with at the time. He didn't have a military might, but it was a spiritual might. So these big armies of the Romans and the others, they could have walked straight through and dealt a heavy blow to those people. But what happened? All of them received the messengers very well, and some of them accepted, some of them did not, and those who did not dishonor the messengers, besides one man. Who was that? Kisra. Why Kisra, the fire worshipper in Iran? What is the reason? The reason is he had no knowledge of the previous books. They used to worship fire, whereas the Jews and the Christians, they had knowledge of the book. So they all honored the messengers, sent the messengers back with gifts in most cases. And as for Najashi, the Negus of Abyssinia, he accepted the message almost instantaneously. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us accept this message. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at one stage started seeing dreams. And these dreams, he would see them at night, and in the morning they would come true as though he is reliving it. This was the first signs of Nubuwa. Just as he was about to get prophethood by the age of 40, this started happening, where he would see dreams and the next day it would happen, it would come. Dream again, it would come true. Dream again, it would come true. Subhanallah. And this led him to secluding himself. So he drove himself away and he used to go northwest of Mecca, a place known as Hira. It was a little cave in a mount. And he used to go there and sit and meditate. And inshallah, tomorrow we will see what happened, inshallah, as he was meditating. What was he meditating over? What exactly happened? And as a result, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. It was the blessing of Allah upon not only Quraysh, but humanity at large. Not only humanity, but the entire existence was blessed by what happened in that grave. In that cave. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May he make us understand and realize this blessing. And may he make us embrace it. Until we meet again tomorrow, inshallah, we say, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Alif lam mim. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum.